Thank you so, so very much. I am thrilled to be here today. You know, what do they say about Texas? Texas does everything big, right? And I have to tell you, I mean, you are what, one of the largest states in the country? You have one of the largest populations in the country. And you gave the United States of America 4 U.S. presidents, right? George W. Bush, George Bush Sr., Dwight Eisenhower, and Lyndon Johnson. So thank you, Texas, for everything that you've given to the U.S. And I want to say that, you know, as I said, everything you do is big, including what I'm seeing here today. Okay, can everybody hear me good? All right. So, as was stated earlier, I've been to Dallas 4 different times, and I cannot thank you enough for your generosity, for the way you welcome me, for your hospitality. As I said, everything you do is big, and I am so, so very grateful. And events like this, they don't just happen magically. It happens because leaders in our community care enough to say, you know what, I want to be able to help you, and I'm going to reach out to my circle of friends to make sure that the event is successful and that candidates like me can compete for public office here in the United States. And with that, although the names have been stated, some things are worth repeating. So I want to say, Chatterjee, thank you so much for taking the lead in this effort. I barely had to say anything to him when I met him in DC several months ago, only told him that I was running for office, and he immediately said, well, I want to bring you down to Dallas and I'm going to do whatever I can to help you. So thank you, Chatterjee, for not only, you know, how you're helping me, but your role as an MP, as being the first NRI to do so. I know that you understand public policy and the important role it plays in people's lives. So thank you for your leadership in our community. To Nilamon, thank you. You are such an eloquent speaker, and what a phenomenal exercise you did. This is so powerful about our engagement here in this country. I thank you for your leadership. I thank you for the way you fight for women's empowerment, and it's been such a pleasure working with you over the years, and I hope we can continue to do so. So thank you. Also to Satish Mandava, thank you for your leadership here in the IT industry. I know Satish and his brother often come to Northern Virginia, and they are politically engaged. They get it. They know the importance of this. So thank you, you know, for willing to host, be part of the host committee. To Dr. Yogi Chimata, thank you so much as well for your leadership. I didn't know that you were an engineer before. This is news to me. Some people are just multi-talented, so thank you. To Dr. Gotapati, you know, your humbleness is really everything that all of us should aspire to be besides all that you've accomplished in our community. And to Wama Yamanchi, thank you, you know, for your leadership as well. And to Nyanya, thank you for being the MC and for the lovely stuff that you said about some of the legislation that I've done. And to I think the young ladies who danced and sang also, you know, what a fantastic job they did they not? Was that great or what? So I'm here tonight to talk about the 1%. I think Nilima calls it the 1.5%. So Indian Americans represent roughly between 1 or 1.5% of the United States population. And you know, we have become, after coming to this country, the most successful minority group in the nation, right? We have physicians, we have entrepreneurs, we have IT professionals, we have people that are comedians now in the Telugu community that have been very successful. We have spelling bee champions. Do you know that Indian American kids represented over 75% of the past Spelling Bee champions in the past 2 decades. So that's, you know, really great to know that we've done that. We also have Nobel Peace Prize winners. We have the CEO of Microsoft, CEO of Adobe. So I can go on and on about the incredible successes that Indian Americans have in this country. And every one of these successes didn't happen just by their own individual effort. It happened because the community created an environment for every one of us to succeed. And I want to talk about that. 1964 was a pivotal time in this nation's country. This is when the civil rights era was happening. Every one of the activists that fought hard to make sure that you and I could have the rights we do today. Those included black activists that were tortured, that were hosed, that were beaten because they stood up for something, a cause that was larger than themselves. And because of that, the Civil Rights Act was passed in 1964, along with the Voter Rights Act. And then, oddly enough, what transpired from those movements is the Immigration Act of 1965. Because of the Civil Rights Act, the United States looked terrible that they had this quota on what type of immigrants were allowed to come to this country. And that included only Caucasian immigrants from Europe that could immigrate to the United States. Because of the Civil Rights Act, Lyndon Johnson saw the inequity and the discrimination the country was using for immigration laws. So then came the Immigration Act of 1965 that he signed right at the Statue of Liberty, signed it right there underneath the statue. This lifted the quota of the immigrants that can come to the United States from places like India, Asia, Africa. And that's the reason why many of us are here today, because of the hard battles that black activists fought for us. So never ever forget that you and I are here because people before us fought for us and died for us so we could be here. And as a result of that, my family, of course, took advantage and came to the United States. So like many of you in this room, I'm also an immigrant. I was born in India, in Andhra, and I came here when I was 7 years old. Like every one of us in this room today, the United States of America has afforded us incredible opportunities. And with great opportunities comes a great responsibility. A responsibility for every one of us to work towards something larger than ourselves, to work towards peace, justice, and equality. And that is the reason why that I got into public service. It's an opportunity for me to give back to a country that has given me so much in the process. And I found that, you know, after being in this country and all the policies that are there, including the Immigration Act and so many other ways, I benefited from that. And as soon as I graduated in civil engineering, I decided that I wanted to devote my life to public service. And it's been, you know, an incredible opportunity, as I said, to bring change and to help others through the process. And in 2010, I had an opportunity to run for public office. And I remember the first time I ran, a gentleman came up to me and he said, "What's a nice girl like you doing in the business of politics?" And I looked at him and I said, "You know, if you ask my 3 daughters, they'll tell you I'm not that nice. And number 2, the business of politics is every one of our business, every one of us. Policy making has an effect on our lives from the moment we wake up till the moment we close our eyes. When you get up and you drink that first glass of water, is that water contaminated in lead or is it clean? You see what's happening in Flint, Michigan. Those are policymakers that decided the bottom line was more important than the public safety. When you send your kids to school, are the schools safe? Are you seeing gun violence? Are they equipped with the resources they need to be successful? Policymakers decide, how are we going to invest in education? When you get up and drive your car down the road, is it congested in traffic? Or are you able to get where you need to? Policymakers decide how we're going to invest in that as well. How much taxes you pay? Policymakers decide that. Whether our country is at war or at peace, policymakers decide this. That's why it's incumbent for every one of us to be engaged. Because if you're not engaged, and I get this a lot from our community, they say, politics and kunchi boring gawantindi. And you know what I tell them? You may think politics is boring and you're not interested, but politics is paying attention to everything you're doing. And it's gonna make decisions that affect you, whether you realize it or not. That's why it's important to be engaged. So I ran for public office, and of course, I was very fortunate that I was able to be successful in 2010 and became a Maryland State Delegate. And in doing so, I became the first Indian American to be elected to the Maryland General Assembly. And I'll tell you, we never talked about politics at the kitchen table with my parents. So this was an eye-opening experience for me just to be there at the policy table. And when I got there, there was so much to learn. And was it scary? You better believe it was, because many of the people who get elected there are people that generation after generation have been exposed to this. And we talked, Neil Lamar, earlier that if there isn't enough of us being elected to office, that's going to prevent other people from running that may want to, because they just don't see anybody that looks like them. So I learned a lot through the process, and the most important thing I learned was that public office is a great instrument to bring positive change to our community and to be able to help others in immeasurable ways. We have a lot of physicians here, and I know that you heal the world, you help patients one patient at a time. We have, engineers who build roadways and other things and, are able to help people in that capacity. Policy making is one big sweep that affects people in the entire state. With one piece of law, you can affect everyone in the state. And that's what I came to realize, how powerful it is to be able to really do good. And unfortunately, you could do bad with it too. But I like to believe every public servant is there with good intentions. And that's what I've learned through the process of serving others. Now, here we are in 2018. And in 2016, I know that presidential election was a big shock for many of us. I know it was for me. And what transpired after that, as you know, we've had an uptick in hate crimes, right? So when we all heard about Srinivas Kojagodla and how he was killed, I know that sent alarms for every one of us in the Indian American community, particularly the Telugu community. And we should be concerned, because what happened there is all of a sudden emerging all over the United States. And you and I have a big role to play in what happens. We cannot just think about what happens to our own community. This is a wake-up call. We need to think about what happens to every individual where injustice is being thrown upon them. And so we need to come together as a community with our brothers and sisters of other minority communities, of other immigrant communities, and say that we're not going to accept this type of behavior, that we're not going to just sit on the sidelines and let these things happen. Because if we do, they'll continue to happen, and it's going to get worse and worse. So it's important for us to be engaged. It's important for us to speak up. It's important for us, as Neelima, you said, to come together with other communities, not just our Telugu community, but every community where, again, that is being threatened and discriminated against, because it only in large volumes can we really bring an effective change together. As I say, united we stand. So I think it's important for all of us to have this engagement. And I want to say that during the 8 years that I've been able to serve the people of Maryland, one of the most important things, not just the most important things, but one way that I was able to help the Indian American community is that in 2011, Maryland governor became the first Maryland governor to visit India. I insisted that we, you know, I took a leadership role to make sure that Maryland went to India and created a sister state relationship. And we did that with Andhra Pradesh. And of course, at the time, it was Andhra and Telangana together. So I was very proud to be able to bring our footprint into the Maryland General Assembly. And after that, our county executive, where I live in Montgomery County, decided that it was also an important measure, and we did a sister city with Hyderabad. So we went there, you know, Montgomery County and Hyderabad, we have a lot in common with the high-tech and biotech region and industry, so we were able to establish this relationship as well. And, you know, there are other ways that affect our Indian American community by laws, whether it's through empowering women. I actually have a piece of legislation in right now that talks about having computer science course available in every high school that it be taught. Right now it isn't. And you know, we know in the digital age as we face that we don't want our children just to be consumers of technology. We want them to be creators of technology. So I have a bill in right now that does exactly that. So, you know, I want to go back again to talk about the climate that we're facing right now in this country. There's a lot of scary stuff that are going on. We have elected officials in US Congress, in fact, one third of them, who do not believe in climate change, science, and facts. Even though 97% of scientists say climate change is real, it's happening right now, and it's going to end civilization if we don't take part in it and combat this. This is a problem. We need to make sure our elected officials understand exactly what is happening to us here in this nation and throughout the world. And even as we face things, and you know, we know that most recently what happened in Florida, the gun violence that is just destroying our country, scaring our children from going to public schools. There are legislators out there who want to change the policy and make sure that we train everyone, our teachers, to know how to use a gun and have guns in school. There are people who believe that that's how we address this problem. So I want to say that as depressing as things may seem right now, I always remember what President Clinton once said. He said, there's nothing wrong in America that can't be cured with what's right in America. So what is right in America? Ian Grillet, who was able to, you know, who was willing to take his own life and save Srinivas Kochavotla, but, you know, unfortunately was not successful. What else is right in America is what, you know, you had said earlier about our founding fathers and me, how they came and they built this country to what it is today, who great men and women who fought for our rights and everything that we have today. What's right in America is every one of you that's in this room today, that works hard, that studied hard, that gives back to our community. That's what's right in America. And so that's what I always remember as I move forward, no matter how grim things may look, no matter how, you know, it doesn't seem like it's gonna get better, and actually it seems like it's getting worse. I always remember that. Never ever give up on America. Never ever give up on the individuals that make up our great country and to what it is today. So as we move forward, I want to leave you with the fact that it is so critical for Indian Americans to have a voice in policy making. You need to have a seat at the table. As they say, if you don't have a seat at the table, then you're likely on the menu. Meaning, the policymakers are going to make all sorts of decisions that affect your life. And unless we have a voice there that represents us, your issues and things that are important to you are not going to be addressed. So that's why it's important for all of us to take part and to be engaged, because together, let's write the next chapter of U.S. history, right? Immigrants before us that came, they worked hard to make this country great. Diversity is not our problem. Diversity is our promise. And we should be proud of our culture. We should be proud of, you know, what we added to this country. And let's continue to fight the good battle on this. I say that I believe in America. That's really the core of why I am a public servant. I've spent my entire life being a public servant. Because I choose hope over fear all the time. And I think President Obama has been a great leader in the past that has inspired so many people when he became the first African-American president to be elected to the United States. That's a, you know, a crack in the glass ceiling that he gave. And I certainly was hoping that, you know, Hillary Clinton would create another crack in that ceiling. But it didn't happen, but we can make it happen when we bring greater diversity to the voices that are going to represent us. So I say that I urge you to flex your citizen muscle, to make sure that you're engaged. And as Nilima, the exercise that you demonstrated, it is so important for us to be there. I'm glad to see that you're registered to vote and that you vote. One other part of the exercise that I should point out that's very critical to how our country moves forward is, in Maryland, and I believe in Texas, also we have closed primaries. So a closed primary means that you can only vote if you're registered with a party in the primary. You'd be surprised how many people don't bother coming out voting in the primary, and they'll just vote in the general election. Let me tell you why that's a bad idea to do. Right now, the way our country is, we have what's called redistricting and gerrymandering. So every 10 years, states get to draw their lines of their electoral, the way that it's drawn, whether it's at the federal level, state level. These lines are drawn such that they're going to basically benefit one party over the other, depending on who the governor of your state is. So let's say, for example, here in Texas, right? You may have, we have a Republican governor. He'll get to redraw the lines, he or she will get to redraw the lines in 2020. And when those lines are drawn, those districts are gonna lean heavily either Republican or Democrat. And again, whichever party is in charge, you can pretty much assure that that party is the one that is gonna lean in that direction. So when you have a primary, you have Democratic candidates competing with one another, Republican candidates competing with one another. Whoever wins both of those is the one that will go on to the general election. So when you keep yourself out of the primary, that is 80% of the electoral process right there. Because chances are, whoever gets out of there, and depending on which way your state leans, that person's already won the general election. That's why it's important that you get out and vote in the primary. Few people understand the significance of that. So please, I urge you to do that in addition to all the other things that you will do by registering to vote and all. And also, as Nilima said, please support candidates from the federal, state, local levels. You know, it doesn't matter if they're Indian American or not. If they represent your core values, support them. Because if you don't support them, candidates can't get elected. And instead, bad candidates will get elected. Now, we also talk a lot about money being in politics. Unfortunately, money isn't everything in politics unless you don't have it, right? So a candidate spent a long time trying to raise money. Why? Why do we do this? Well, the reason why is funding allows us to reach our voters. And to reach our voters, you have to either send mailers, you have to take radio ads, or you go on television. These are all very expensive ways in which how we reach voters. You can't just do it by knocking on doors, because a congressional district represents 760,000 residents. You can't go knock on all those doors and introduce yourself. So that's why we need to be able to have the funding. And that's where you all have an opportunity to support the candidates that you believe in. Again, let me remind you, you're here benefiting from the policies that are being written by candidates who get elected. It's in your best interest to make sure that you play your role in our democracy. Don't just give it to only the 20% that get out and vote every year. That 20% is determining 100% of the policies that are being written for all of us. So please, please, I urge you to make sure that, you know, again, vote and support the candidates that you believe in. And finally, I say, never ever leave out of the equation that you can run for public office one day. To Lakshmi Gadu, thank you for having the courage and running. I know it's not easy, and it's not unusual for candidates to run and lose the first time. Get back up and do it again, because we believe in you and we're there to support you. And so we'd love to see you run again and give other people the inspiration to run. So, and you know, finally, I want to say that people often ask me, so why are you running for Congress? Why don't you just stay where you are, Aruna, where you're a delegate, and my party is the majority party, the Democrats, in the Maryland General Assembly. I have to say that I've been very blessed to be part of the General Assembly and to create this positive change in our state. But I don't like what's happening at the national level. There's a lot of negative rhetoric that's happening there, policies that are being implemented that are gonna affect every one of us. And Satish Gadu, you talked a little bit about the whole H-1B visa program. Let me tell you what's happening on that. At the national level, the H-1B visa program, there is no policy there right now. So it's really subject to whoever is the president. If they want to go ahead and stop people from coming into this country indiscriminately, they can do that. And I have heard several stories since President Trump has been elected where Indian Americans who are on H-1B visa have been stopped at the airport. And for no reason whatsoever, Homeland Security says, you gotta leave the country, that's it. That's a problem. These are people that came to this country, raised their kids here, they bought a home here, they're taxpayers. We benefit from them being here in so many ways. So we need to make sure that that is addressed, and that we can't just, you know, continue to just let it go by like this and cross your fingers that everything is going to be okay, that the next president who's there is going to go ahead and look out for our best interests. It's not going to happen. We need to elect people that are going to make sure that this is a priority. And we do this by electing more Indian Americans to the U.S. Capitol. Another thing that I want to say is that we've been very successful in this country, and that's great. You know, when you're successful, you're adding value to your life, to those of your kids. But it's important for us to take our economic success and convert that into social significance, right? So that means that when we're able to have a seat at the policy table, then we're really there to create significant changes that affect people's lives beyond yourself and your family. And that's where it's important for all of us to take part in this role to make sure that we create the change that we're looking for as we move forward as a nation together. And that means that we gotta make sure every life matters, Black, white, Asian, Hispanic. We need to make sure that women have equal rights when it comes to their social, political, legal, and reproductive rights. We need to make sure that healthcare is available for every citizen of America, because healthcare is not a luxury, it's a necessity for one to succeed in this life, in this world. You know, we currently spend over 18% of our GDP on healthcare. We went from 5% to 18%. And so we have to make sure that if we're going to spend this kind of money, that people are, do you know the number one reason people claim bankruptcy? It's because of medical bills. So clearly we're doing something wrong. We need to fight for this to make sure that we bring the change. And I'm sure every one of the physicians here, they've been saddled with all the regulations that are out there. And I want to make sure that we can work to, you know, we can create this change. And finally, I just want to say that, you know, our democracy and our country depends on every one of us. Every one of us to be engaged. And if we're not, it's not just about us. More importantly, it's about the future of our children. Let's make sure that the America that we leave behind for our children is even better than the one that we were given. And this means, again, every one of us to be engaged, to sit at the table, to make sure the policies reflect our values. And I'm looking forward to running for the United States Congress. And once elected, and we will get elected, we will become, for the first time, a Telugu voice is going to go to the U.S. Capitol, first time in U.S. history. Right? And this is our collective Telugu voice. And I can't wait for that to happen, because once we do this, you know, the significance of that is so, it's just incredible what we can do together at the U.S. Capitol. But more importantly, it's about making sure that we have role models available for the children that we're bringing into this world, so they know the importance of what they can do as we move forward together. Again, I want to thank you all so much for giving me this incredible opportunity to represent you, even if it's at the, you know, Maryland state level. And I'm looking forward to representing you at U.S. Congress. As Chatterjee said, that, you know, this is not a limited area of scope. This is 535 people get elected to U.S. Congress to represent 320 million of us in this country. So it's in your best interest to make sure, even if you live in Texas, and I'm going to be a representative from Maryland, that we make sure that we elect people, all 535 of them, to make sure that they reflect our values. So again, I want to thank you for your generosity, for opening your hearts, for believing in our campaign, and I can't wait to see you all there on November 6, 2018, when our Telugu voice will be heard for the first time in U.S. history. Thank you for everyone for being here.